This program was paid for by Water of Life Church. From Water of Life Ministries in Plano, Texas, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob is speaking through his servants to the world. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying today. Let us join Doyle Davidson and others of Water of Life, sowing the Word of God in spirit and in truth.
Hello, I'm Doyle Davidson, servant and apostle of the Lord Jesus Christ, ministering locally to the body of Christ in Dallas and Fort Worth, Texas, sent by God to your house to declare unto you the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians 15, 3 and 4 tell us what the gospel is, how that Jesus Christ died for our sins according to Scripture. He was buried. He rose again the third day according to the Scripture. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Pardon me, because he's anointed me. He's anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor, sent me to heal the brokenhearted, preach deliverance to the captives, recovering the sight to the blind, set at liberty them that are bruised. Thank God. Amen. The word is nigh thee, even in your heart, in your mouth is a word of faith which I preach. If you will confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. With the heart, man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth, confession is made unto salvation. Thank God, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. Therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by his faith. I want to welcome everyone that is viewing this on television, live stream, Roku, thank God, YouTube, or other devices, and hearing us on shortwave radio. Welcome, all of you, throughout the world. It's a great pleasure to be preaching this gospel throughout the entire world. Thank God. Thank God, 7 days a week from this building. Thank God. A great blessing to be doing it. And I'm happy. We have with us the minister, starting off one of my boys with a song, Great One, it is finished, followed by Kathie Davidson preaching the gospel, followed by Water Black Boys, There Stood a Lamb, followed by Terre and the Browns, Worthy the Lamb. And then you're going to get me. I'll be back talking about 2003, 28th of November, flying to Providence, Rhode Island, and then visiting Plymouth. Thank God. Now, here's Water of My Boy.
It was written of God. horizon, there is no need to fear. So run and not be weary, walk and never faint. Lift up your voice to heaven and crown Him Lord and King. It is finished, Christ is come. It was written of God's Son. For behold, the Lamb has fulfilled God's plan, and it is finished, and He has just begun. He is the Lord of lords. He is the King of kings, Prince of peace, everlasting peace. Crown Him with glory, Almighty God. It is finished, Christ is come. It was written on God's Son. For behold, the Lamb has fulfilled God's plan, and it is finished, and He has just begun. He has just begun.
In just a few days, we're going to be celebrating Christmas. And I want to look at that Christmas message today, probably in a light that you've never seen it. If you will turn with me to Luke 2, I'm going to begin in verse 1, familiar passages. And it came to pass in those days, there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went to be taxed, everyone to his own city. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, unto Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was the house and lineage of David. If you look in the book of Micah, it said that Jesus had to be born in Bethlehem. What a great way to get him there, taxing. It said, and be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, being great with child. And so it was while they were there, so that the word could be accomplished. It says she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, wrapped him in swaddling clothes, and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. Laid him in a manger, in swaddling clothes. And it says, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. You know, ever since I was a young girl, One of my favorite times of Christmas, and a lot of you will agree with me, was the Charlie Brown Christmas show on television. And this passage that Linus read always, always, even from this size, ministered to me. And it says, and there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord, right here, one angel, came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto the shepherds abiding in the field, fear not. Behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people, that's you and I, with great joy will be to all people. For unto you is born this day, born in the city of David, a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger. And suddenly there was with that one angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest. And on earth, peace peace, goodwill toward men. Now, what was born? What was born in that manger? What was laid in that manger? Turn with me to John 1. I'm going to begin in verse 1. In the beginning, before the world was, in the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. I talked about this several months ago. That means there were two in the beginning. Two. One was God, one was with God and God. So there were two at least. The same was in the beginning with God. So there's two or three now in heaven. There had to be at least two because it said the Word was with God and the Word was God. The only way you can do that is to have two. And it says all things were made by him. And without him was not anything made that was made. Look at verse 4. In him was life. Was life. And the life was the light of men. And the light shineth in darkness. And the darkness comprehended it not. Look at verse 4 again. It says, in him was life. Let's take a look at that life. Go with me to Proverbs 8. These are some wonderful passages. I'm going to first show you in verse 35 of Proverbs 8. It says, for whosoever findeth me findeth life. So now we know this is the same one that was in John 1 because it said, in him was life. And the life was the light of men. Here it says that you find me, you find life. So this is talking about Jesus. This passage that we're about to read is talking about Jesus before he came to earth, before he was born. Verse 23, and I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning, or ever the earth was. So he was before the earth ever was. When there were no depths, I was brought forth. When there were no fountains abiding with water. Before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth. It says, while as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heavens, I was there. When he strengthened the fountains of the deep. When he gave to the sea his decree that the water should not pass his commandment. When he appointed the foundations of the earth, then I was with him. I was with him. And I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him, rejoicing in the habitable part of the earth. And my delights were with the sons of men. Now therefore, hearken unto me, O you children, for blessed are they that keep my ways. Hear instruction and be wise and refuse it not. Blessed is the man that heareth me, watching daily at my gates, waiting at the posts of my doors. For whoso findeth me, findeth life, and shall obtain favor of the Lord. But he that sinneth against me wrongeth his own soul, and all they that hate me love death. This was what was with the Father before the earth was. Back to John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Now go to verse 14. And the Word, the one that was with God before the earth ever was, the one that was daily his delight. It says, and the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us. And we beheld his glory, the glory is the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. What does it say? And the Word became flesh. It became flesh. Go with me to Hebrews 2. I'm going to begin in verse 16. For verily he took on not him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Jesus took on the seed of Abraham. He didn't take on the seed of an angel. Angels aren't born and they don't die. But what does it say in Luke 2? Let's go back to Luke 2 real quick. It says, verse 11, for unto you is born this day. Born. Have you ever thought about that? This is God, and now he's born. Now he's born. He becomes a baby. 9 months in the womb of a woman. You know, it says later on, I think it's verse 21 there, it says that he was conceived by Mary, conceived. So that means that Mary had to take her into her womb by an egg, by the Holy Ghost, and now we have a baby. A baby. Not something that appeared, but something that was conceived, and he was born. The God that was with God, that was the Word of God, became a baby. Do you know, if you ever thought about a baby can't feed itself. A baby can't clothe itself. It can't walk around. It can't even speak. It can't even take itself to the bathroom. This is what Jesus became. He became one of us, not an angel, and he didn't appear on the earth. He didn't just appear. He was born. Why was he born? Why did he become a baby? Why did he have to totally be dependent on his parents? Why did he have to trust his parents that they were going to bring him up? They had to trust his parents that they were going to feed him. He had to trust his parents that they were going to keep him warm. Why? Now, let's go back to Hebrews 2, verse 16. For he verily took on not him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. He became one of us. One of us. Were you born? I think pretty much everybody in this congregation and is listening to me were born. Were born. He said, verily he took on him the nature of angels, but he took on him the seed of Abraham. Wherefore in all things. You see that word all? You see that word all? All things. It behooved him to be made like unto his brethren. It behooved him. He thought it necessary to become just like us. And if he's going to be just like us, he had to be born. He had to be born. He had to be a baby, and then a young toddler, and then a child, and then a teenager, and then an adult. And he said, why? Wherefore, in all things, it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, that he might be a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God to make reconciliation for the sins of the people. For in that he himself has suffered being tempted, he is able to succor, help them that are tempted. He found out exactly what it was like to be a human, a person. He became one of us, one of us. He had the same temptations, it tells us in Hebrews, as we had. He was cold on some days, like yesterday. He was hungry. It said that when he went to met the woman at the well, that he sat down because he was hungry and he was waiting for somebody to bring him some food. He was thirsty. He became just like us. Now, why would the man, the God that was with God, that made the world, that was daily with the Father in heaven, a light that man can't even approach to, for there for eternity, daily the Father's delight. Why would somebody like that give it all up? Give it all up and become a baby. A baby. Let's go to Hebrews 10. We are going to see Jesus himself here speaks why. Why he did this. It says verse 5, Hebrews 10. Wherefore? When he cometh into the world, this is Jesus. When he cometh into the world, how did he come into the world? As a baby. You know, a baby starts as one cell. One cell. Jesus became one cell. And then it grew. And it grew into a child, a baby. And he was born. He just didn't appear in 9 months. He grew from one cell. That's when life starts, folks. That is what the Word of God says. And Jesus became a baby. And it says, Jesus himself, wherefore, when he cometh into the world, he said, sacrifice and offering thou wouldest not, but a body hast thou prepared me. A body. Jesus had to have a body. He had to have a body. and we'll find out why he had to have a body. And to have a body like us, he had to be born. That baby had to be born. And it was for us that he was born. Isaiah 9 says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given." Jesus himself said, "A body, Father, thou hast prepared me. You gave me a body." Let's go on with that. It says, "But a body hast thou prepared me. In burnt offerings and sacrifice for sins, thou hast had no pleasure. Then said I," this is Jesus speaking, "lo, I come. In the volume of the book, it is written of me to do thy will." To do the will of the Father. I gave it all up to do the will of the Father. To do the will of the Father. What was the will of the Father? Turn with me to John 7, or John 12, verse 27. This is Jesus speaking. He is now 33 years old. He has been on the earth for 33 years. He came, and while he was here, while those 33 years, especially the last 3.5, you know what he did? He showed us exactly how to walk with God. He showed us exactly how we can walk with God. He walked it for us. He was our example. He showed the disciples, this is what you do when you come up against this. This is where you go here. This is how you follow my word. This is follow me. And then he walks on the water. And you know what? Peter walked on the water too. He showed us exactly how to walk with God. And then, the very reason he came, let's start in verse 27. Jesus is speaking. He's getting ready to go to Jerusalem, and he's getting ready to die on the cross. And he says, "Now is my soul troubled, but what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour." Look at this next phrase. "But for this cause came I unto this hour." Why was that baby born? For the very hour Jesus was getting ready to go to. That baby was born of a woman, raised with a mother and father, became an adult, showed us how to walk with God, baptized in the Holy Spirit. You know, he never could do a miracle until he was baptized in the Holy Spirit. Why? He was our example. He was showing us exactly how to do this. He was our example. And for 3.5 years, he was our example. And then, for the very reason he came, the very cause he came, he made a way so that we could walk the same way. He was the one that paved the way for us. And the only way to pave a way to get us to walk, to be sons and daughters of God, was to die. Was to die. He had to overcome death. The only way somebody can die is they have to be born. You can't die if you're not born. You can't die unless you're born. Jesus was born. He was born so he could die. And when he died, he took on our sin. He took on everything that was between us and the Father. He took on our sin. That body on the cross took our perversities. He took our weaknesses. He took our sickness. He took the disease, our disease. He took our perverseness. He took on everything that was between us and the Father. Why? That's why he was born. That's why the Father sent him. That's why when the shepherds heard, they said, "Peace on earth, goodwill to men." Why are we so excited that this baby's born? Because he's going to die. Because our sacrifice came into the world to live, to show us how to walk, and then to die for us. And you know what's so wonderful about that death? It satisfied the Father. The death of Jesus, crucified on the cross, every bone out of joint, carrying our deficiencies, carrying our sins, our sicknesses, our poverty, our weakness, our fear, our mental diseases. He took it all and he satisfied the Father. And then the Father raised him from the dead. The Father said, you are no more dead. You will no more be dead. You have satisfied me concerning all of us. Concerning all. You have satisfied me. Now come out of the grave. Now come out of the grave. And when Jesus was raised, our sins were forgiven. Our sicknesses were healed. Our poverty ended. All we have to do to receive it, to manifest it in front of us so that we walk in it, is to believe it. Now let's go back to Luke 2 and we'll finish. Let's take a look again at what the angels told the shepherds. It says, and the angel said unto them, fear not, for behold, I bring you good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. Why? Because he's born so he could die so we could live. He was born so he could die so we would live. When Jesus was raised from the dead, we were raised with him so that we could live. And let's finish. It says, for unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord, a Savior. The man that came to die for us, to be buried for us, to be raised again for us. And you shall find a sign unto you. You'll find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying in a manger. And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host. A multitude. Can you imagine? Out in the field, a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace. Why peace? Because he came to die for us. Because he came to be buried and to be raised again for us. And on earth, peace, goodwill toward men. Goodwill towards you. Goodwill towards you. The Father had Jesus born for you. Unto us a son is given. Unto us a child is born for you. Unto us. He was sent here for you. He was sent here to forgive you. He was sent here to heal you. He was sent here to get rid of your poverty so you could be rich, a son and a daughter of God. He was sent for you, and he was sent in good will for you. Now, what do you have to do? You have to say thank you. And how do you say thank you? Romans 10:10 says, if you believe in your heart that Jesus was raised from the dead and you speak it with your mouth, thank you, Father, Jesus came. He died, he was buried, and he was raised again for me. The word of God says you shall be saved. Have the water of life boys up here minister that same power that brought Jesus out of the grave, the same power that raised him up and us up. Amen.
Worthy to go. For no one in heaven, no one in earth was worthy to open the scroll. Then one of the elders said, John, don't you weep. It was all part of the plan. And there in the middle of God's glorious throne, hallelujah, there stood a lamb. And they sang, worthy, worthy of honor and praise. They were casting down crowns and praising his name. And he said, are you worthy? I could hear Jesus saying, I am. Oh, praise God forever. There stood a lamb. Now open your Bible. Open your heart. It's clear we are in the last days. For he said, I'll come quickly. So don't be surprised when he comes back to take us away. And the feeble excuses won't get very far when you find yourself there at his throne. But if you know Jesus, he is your Lord, hallelujah, won't be alone, and we'll sing worthy, worthy of honor and praise.
Hear the cries of the shackled from the onset of time. For the chains of defeat, there's no key. See the tears of the broken, the cries of the slaves. Is there no one worthy to set us free? Then the crying is stilled as the chorus rings out. The shackled released from their chains. Thousands of voices are swelling the song.
Directed me to start flying all 48 states of the mainland and pray. We left that day. During the first trip, we ended August 27th, 2004. On the morning of November 28th, 2013, I, along with six staff members, flew out of McKinney Regional Airport, headed for New Bedford, Massachusetts, expecting to land in New Bedford and go to Plymouth and also Providence, Rhode Island. One interesting thing I will tell you, we were on a plane of a president of a food supplier in America, a very well-known food. And if you'll ask me after the program, I'll tell you whose plane it was. But I don't want to tell the world, but I'll let you know. Amen. And it was a very nice plane, the president's plane, and the president's pilot. Thank God, good friends. We flew on our way to New Bedford, Massachusetts. We intended, I wanted to go to Providence. However, I could not find an SUV at Providence that we could all ride in, seven of us. And we were going to be in it 3 hours plus break. So as we arrived or got close to New Bedford, the captain said, Doyle, Paul just moved in over New Bedford. We can't land there. I said, what are you talking about? He said, it just appeared. We can't land there. The closest we can get to it is Providence. I said, Providence? That's where I wanted to go. But I couldn't get an SUV. I said, let's go, Providence. God will supply. We landed in Providence. They were sent two SUVs. Which one do you want? One's enough. What a great victory. How God directs my feet, orders my steps, even orders airplanes. And I fly along with other staff members. So we take out, if I recall, south part of Massachusetts is a bunch of cranberry growers. And we drove to Plymouth. I'd never been there. I did not know what to expect. And I heard there was a replica of the Mayflower there. I was excited as the next person to go to Plymouth. At that time, I was not aware of my ancestors settling a lot of that country, establishing the first six principal churches in that area. We'll take that up a little later. But when we got to Plymouth, there was that little boat, about that wide, about that long. Goodness sakes. I had been in the Navy 4 years and spent 15 days in the Pacific in 1953. But we weren't on that thing. My goodness. I don't recall everything, but it seems that Mayflower traveled somewhere about maybe 2 miles an hour. I'm not sure that's right. A bunch of historians know all this. But my goodness, those people came because God sent them. God sent them. Miles Standish was on there, and David Casperite, one of my co-workers, vice president, Order of Black Ministries, is a descendant of Miles Standish. Thank God. Then, Sadie Peter, a descendant. Was that a Brewster?
Bradford.
Oh, Bradford, that's right. I didn't know I was going to do this. Thank God. Amen. Kathie D., who are you a descendant of?
Brewster, William Brewster.
I thought I got you two Swiss. And me, no. Nobody that I was related to was on the Mayflower. Thank God. However, I was related to six ministers that ministered in Massachusetts and Rhode Island and other areas. We'll take it up later. It was really an exciting day for me to be where the Pilgrims were not supposed to have landed. But God directed that little, I call it a boat. I'm sure they called it a ship. Amen. Thank God. It was a great blessing to be where our ancestors came on the Mayflower, not mine, but I did have ancestors come there on another one of little ships a year or two later. It's just heartwarming to think that God sent that group. They had a tough time getting there. You need to read about them. Not all lived. But God is God. The ones he wanted to live, they got there. A great story about the Pilgrims. You can read it about it on my website, or from it. You'll find a lot about it. Thank God. We left Plymouth and we drove north. I'm not sure where we went today. It's been, what, 12 years? Friday. That was the 28th of November. This is the 29th, I believe. Only 12 years later. And I'm not sure how far north we went. I seem to remember it was a triangle. We got a certain place and turned south. And as when we turned south, immediately I got a headache. I don't have headaches. Rarely. Headaches. But fighting religious spirits, I get headaches. I can almost tell. Well, I just picked up a religionist. In the spirit, I've got a headache. As we were driving along, I said, my goodness, some religious spirit is confronting me. Much to my surprise, the information read to me. It's where the First Baptist Church was established in America, Providence, Rhode Island. And religious spirits don't like me. Very interesting about that country. Roger Williams started the first church in Providence in 1638, I believe it was. And it was not called a Baptist church. It was a sixth principle church, Hebrews 6, verse 1. And interesting about Roger Williams, one of my, I think, 9th or 10th great-grandfather, Ezekiel Holloman, baptized Roger Williams in water. And then Roger Williams baptized the rest of them. And then Roger Williams left the group. I believe he said there was no apostle. But God was there. We don't know who all of them were, but God knew every one of them. He knew his purpose. He knew their heart. Later in 2010, perhaps, I find I'm a descendant of four, and later two more great people from Great Britain that established Rhode Island. My 9th great-grandfather, Samuel Gordon, another great-grandfather, John Warner, another one, Stokely Westcott, another one, Ezekiel Holloman, and two later, one named, what, Obadiah Holmes, and the fourth one, or the sixth one, I forgot. In fact, I've never seen the names of any of them. But God has blessed this ministry. and brought forth descendants of the early settlers of the East Coast. It has been a great blessing to learn in 2010, 11, 12, where I came from, where David Gasparite came from, Sadie Peters, Kathie Davidson. Thank God. And let me tell you, folks, God gave this land to our ancestors. I'm talking about, I'm a descendant. Everybody that I just mentioned is. And he brought them here with the kingdom of God that was in Israel. The days of Jesus. And it's prophesied that they would come to a country that would bring forth fruit thereof. That's America. Here's the fruit. Uh-oh, not all. But my friend, my people are all fruit. Well, there'll be coming fruit. We've got a few years ahead before the return of Jesus in the cloud. A few years, I don't think very many, maybe seven, somewhere in that area. Nobody knows. Jesus didn't know, just the Father. It's not going to be long, folks, until Jesus comes. I want you to believe. In the name of Jesus. Mix faith with it. And you can be saved. Just call Jesus, 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 Jesus. God bless you. See you next time.
We invite you to visit Water of Life Church at 1621 18th Street in Plano, Texas. Or for further information, call area code 972-578-8082. That's 972-578-8082. Or write Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. That's Doyle Davidson, Post Office Box 861327, Plano, Texas 75086. This program was paid for by Water of Life Church.